Can I just tell you, Tracy, a story about this? I don't know if you remember our whole, when I FaceTime her, she was running around in the subway. She was so excited to talk to you.
I was at the airport.
That's so good. Of course I remember that.
Yeah, she's like, been gushing over you for the longest time.
Oh my God.
So we're excited about
you. I feel like I manifested this to happen because
she did.
Listening to why you're not married yet. Okay. I legit was like, I feel like she's my best friend. Like, I like listening to your book. It literally is like, I feel like you're listening to your best friend, like the big sistery. I'm like, I want to be her friend.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Best Friends with Benefits. I am Noni.
I'm Kristen.
Kristen, I know.
Oh my God. I'm like fangirling out over here. We have the most amazing person on today. She is a writer, a relationship expert, a TV host for Family or Fiance, and it's Tracy McMillan!
Yay! You guys, I can't believe we're finally together after all of this.
We're finally,
stuff.
I know, finally together. Thank you for bearing with us.
We're so excited to have you.
Like, I'm happy to be here.
So excited.
Beyond.
Thank you.
I know a lot of people are tuning in right now to get all of these relationship gems. So we're going to dive right into
Let's do it.
Before we do that, though, I'd love for you to give us just a Cliff Notes version of the roadmap to how you came to be a relationship expert.
You know what? I always say I got here the hard way. I was married and divorced 3 times. I could not figure out my love life. I'm still barely figuring it out. You know, I think a lot of relationship expert people are like people who got married once 35 years ago. And I just look at them and I'm like, you don't know me. Okay.
You don't know real life.
You don't know what about
that's not trial and error at all.
What you tell me about you got married once and it worked? I don't know what to say, but you certainly can help me. So I do. So how did that happen? So I got married the last time. What year are we in? It was 15 years ago, 16 years ago. Wow. And that marriage ended after 10 months. I always say I got married once each in the 80s, 90s, and 00s. And one time I was a teenager, and one time I was pregnant, and one time I was just stupid, okay? but it's only, it's all sacred, number one. And it's only an opportunity to learn. Like, I just get to up-level and expand every time. I don't have to, like, sit and, like, hate on myself or get into recrimination. I just have to let it help me grow. So after that last time, I started to really understand that I had big things that needed to be worked out in this area, and I couldn't just do what came naturally anymore, or I was going to continue to have the same experience. So, you know, I have not been married since then. I have not lived with anyone since then. I really pulled in and started to just work on my stuff. And sometimes I say I'm the jailhouse lawyer of relationship experts, right? I'm like, I've done so much work on my own case. Now I can help you with yours. And a lot of what I say is from experience. Along the way, about 10 years ago, I wrote this piece called Why You're Not Married, which was sort of a comedic thing. It was just an essay because, you know, my day job, I'm a television writer. And so I write things and that's how I, you know, that's my thing. And a TV writer friend had said, you should do a staged reading at this place. It was called Sit and Spin. And it was a stage reading series. And I was like, well, what should I write about? And she was like, well, write about what only you can write about. And I'm like, well, I've been married 3 times. I could write about that. So I wrote this piece called Why You're Not Married. It's sort of tongue in cheek, but it was also true. And later, and it was like, I read it out loud and people just responded like crazy. And I was like, whoa, this is weird. And then a little while later, maybe a couple years later, I put it on the Huffington Post. And the next thing I know, it was the most it was the most read on the Huffington Post for like 3 years. And I started doing tons of TV and I got a book deal. And then I went on Oprah's Super Soul Sunday. And then I know it was just like this crazy thing. And then I got another show on the Oprah Winfrey Network. And it's just like when your side hustle blows up, but really it's like when you start to use the worst things that have ever happened to you and share them as experience, people, that's what we all need. It's just to be humanized in the areas where we struggle the most. So that's how I became a relationship expert. And really all I do is share from my own experience. That's basically it. And I mean, also I'm extremely, I basically have a, I'm an unlicensed therapist. Like I have studied for a marriage and family master's degree, basically just on my own. In fact, I'll be in therapy and my therapist will be like, oh my God, that's really good. Can I use that? And I'll be like, sure. You know, sure. Why am I paying you? No, it's fine. He's amazing. Yeah. So him. I'm a work in progress though, and I'm constantly updating and I'm very science and evidence-based. I'm interested in what the research is about relationships.
All right. Let's follow up on that book. Since you really dove into the book, Kristen, is there like,
oh, I've listened to it three times. And when I first listened to it, I literally was like, oh my God, like this sounds like Noni talking to me. Like things, and even in the book, it's like things your best friends really want to tell you, but it's like, won't tell you to your face. And I literally,
like it's being like your friend. Yeah.
Big sistery, just truth. Like the first chapter is like, you're not married yet because you're a bitch. Like it's so funny, but it's so true and it's so real. And I recommend anyone listening to this to get the book on Audible because listening to you talk to someone like that, just like straight talk, but it's such a loving way. It changed my life. It has changed my life.
Well, I think
and I'm still single.
That's okay.
So I listen to it over and over again.
But I think the bottom line is that it really is about loving. That's my whole message. It's about practicing love and being loving. And I don't think I walked into the world of relationships like that. I walked into the world of relationships going, how do I get my needs met? How do I get what I want? How do I get fill in the blank, a baby, a picket fence, you know, a meaning.
Right.
I did not see men as people. Honestly, it's crazy. But I was not, I am not alone. I see it all the time. I had a friend text me the other day. She's like, you know, he's saying these things in this text. And like, I really just think, and the whole tone is like already in an adversarial relationship with a text. I was like, no. You need to put that down and start figuring out how to just open your heart and listen to this person and stop thinking everything he's doing is wrong. She's like, he's very self-centered. I'm like, he's a man. Okay. Like,
I love that. And you're like, love
me. With that. I mean,
you're like, one of the, it's so true. Cause one of the parts in your book, you're like, I have a teenage son and ladies, let me tell you, this is basically what you're going to get.
Perfectly good men are incredibly self-centered. It's fine. Yeah. It's not that big of a deal. You don't have to like get in it all the time. You just let them be. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You just let them be.
Yeah.
You just gotta let men be.
So powerful. And then I love the last part of the book where you're like, you know, there's a spiritual side to this and you literally what you just shared before about like meeting someone randomly, like you literally never know how you're going to meet someone.
Never know. And here's the thing. Okay. So I'll say a little bit. So I've said this on my Instagram a little bit, not a lot, but so we're breaking news here, you guys.
But hot off the press.
Relationship with somebody that I met on a plane. And in the moment of meeting on the plane, you know, we kind of looked at each other and said, where do you live? Wait, where do you live? I mean, it wasn't like we were pre-qualifying each other. It really wasn't the tone of the meeting. The tone of the meeting was a really kind of something, human connection. Great. But just you know, it's sort of in the back of your mind. You're like, well, there's no way that could work. We live 2,200 miles away in two cities that have nothing to do with each other. It wasn't like New York and LA. You know what I'm saying? But I was just joking with him the other day and I said, yeah. And then the universe is like, hold my beer. I got a pandemic for you. Okay.
Wow.
And then suddenly something becomes possible that wasn't possible. And I just think you have to live in that realm of infinite possibility at all times in order to have things that are outside of what you currently understand to happen. And that's a choice.
Oh, so good. Oh my God. We love you. So
many gems. You mentioned a book deal. Are there more books coming? Or
you know, right now I'm doing a lot of things in the area of television and film. I have four projects that I'm working on. One is, and they're in various stages of development. And I've been so sort of focused on that. I haven't really been thinking about another book. But just in the last month, I've been sort of going, what other things can I do in this area? To basically, you know, I've come to understand that what you need to do in life is what no one else can do. Like, what is it that no one else can do except you? And it, now this isn't true in the beginning of my career. I'm like, give me that cop drama. I'll work on that, you know? Right. But as I'm now 14 years into my television writing career, it's like, what show can only I do? That's the one I need to spend my energy on. The way I learned this lesson is I was on this show called Ready for Love. And the very first night, we were having our big shoot and they gave me this dress to wear. And they were like, they want you to wear this. I'm like, what? That's over the top. Like, I want to be under the top. And they were like, nope, you need to wear this. And I realized that of every person in the studio, I was the only person actually who could wear that dress. And I was like, this is what I need to be knowing in my whole life is like, I need to spend my energy doing what only I can do. Being in the relationships only I can be in. Doing the jobs only I can do. Now, that's a goal. You can't always live there. Sometimes you just got to pay the rent. That's fine.
Mm-hmm.
But that's where I am. And so I'm like, well, what is it that only I can do? Well, this thing. This is it. So I'm looking towards segueing into a podcast. People are always like, you got to do a podcast. And then I think maybe do some like webinars. And then from there, maybe do another book. That was a long answer, but there's always something in there.
No, that was really, really great. I mean, shoot, that was such a gem. Just about, you can take that anywhere in life.
Anywhere.
Yeah.
Now I know. And I say it to other people too. It's like, whenever you're trying to make decisions, you know?
Yeah. So this kind of is about my own personal experience because I've been on five dates with one guy. And I know that you talk about attachment styles a lot.
Yeah.
And so I wanted you to just share to our audience a little bit about that. Like sometimes that
attachment
feeling.
It's so embedded in every single interaction that you're having in dating and all the ways you perceive the world. So there's basically four different attachment styles. Your attachment style is more or less set at a young age. But we do have a lot of brain plasticity as humans. And so if you really focus on it, you can shift your attachment style. But I always describe it as being like a language. So it's like if you're a native French speaker, you're always going to speak French, you know, potentially speak French with a, you know, English accent or whatever, you know what I'm trying to say. And then in times of stress, you might revert to the native language. But you can learn a new way. So I'm not saying you're damned, but most of us never move out of our attachment, our original attachment strategy. So here's the four types. They're secure. We don't care about them because whatever. Okay. They have the great lives. They get married once. They got it worked out. You know, it's fine. We love you guys. I want to be one of you. I'm working on it. So then there's anxious. That's me. Okay. Anxious is, this is all like about, how you're oriented to the world and your primary attachment figure. That would be for most people, that's their mother. So an anxious person basically doesn't, their caregiver was intermittently attentive. So sometimes they got it, sometimes they didn't, and they have a tendency to be hypervigilant and keep a very close eye on the primary attachment figure, also known as your boyfriend or your girlfriend or your husband or your wife. So, and they're clingy and needy. This is how they come across in the times when they're really stressed. Other times they're like really fun and emotional. Like there's wonderful things about being anxiously attached. Well, the unwonderful thing is that we really, really like the third kind of attachment style, which is avoidant. The avoidant.
Oh yeah.
The avoidant did not consistently get their needs met. They stopped going to people for their needs. And they are sort of distant, self-reliant, private. You know, this is like your classic avoidant guy or avoidant woman who, here's how you know an avoidant. When a need comes up, they do what's called derogating anger. So they'll be like, fuck them. You know, here's an avoidant basically. Fuck that. Fuck them, fuck that. And you're like, I wish I could be like that. I'll always be like, see, I don't have that in me. I don't have that in me. I'm like, I care all the time. So these two people find each other a lot and it can be really difficult and it can be a very toxic combination because it's so hard to work out. But it doesn't mean that you can't do it. It just means both people have to be aware and begin to take secure functioning actions in their relationships. And as I take secure functioning actions, my relationships become secure functioning for that hour or that breath or that day. It's not, and then little by little, you can be what's called earned secure, where you're basically secure. I'd say I'm basically very secure at work. I still am working on it in the area of relationships, but I'm in a relationship with somebody who's on the avoidance side, but also is working on it. So we're in agreement that we're trying to get to secure functioning. And very often it'll be like, well, the secure functioning choice right here, I'll just ask myself, what would the secure functioning choice be? And then I'll do that. And what happens is when you do that choice, the other person does not get freaked out and move into their defensive strategy, you know? Right. So you end up having a new experience just by one person doing something new. And wow. Then the rest of the time when they're doing their shit, God bless them, you just take your eyes off of them and start looking at what it's bringing up in you and start working on healing that and going to your girlfriends, you know, instead of constantly trying to chase after this avoidant.
Oh, you,
oh my gosh.
I see you at the front of like a whole lecture hall giving a class on this. That is fascinating. And I know people are listening is like, that's me. Wait, I'm not one. You could probably be different styles in different areas of life.
Yeah, absolutely. When I was younger, I was more on the avoidant side. I broke up with everybody. I was the one who was like, sometimes if somebody's secure with or like anxious with me, I'll flip into the other thing. So it's like, it's almost more like a triangle that you can move around. I'm adapting that from this thing called the Cartman drama triangle. The Cartman drama triangle is victim, perpetrator, enabler.
Ooh.
And the thing about it is you move around the triangle and your goal is to get off the triangle. But what if attachment had a similar kind of fluidity at times.
Yeah.
That's so interesting. I just made that up. Yeah.
Oh, you should just go pad that right now. Noni, what would you say you are?
What's that?
I'm definitely anxious for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They're anxious.
You said what people?
Anxious people usually know they're anxious.
Yeah.
Avoidant people prefer not to think about it.
I think, Noni, what do you think you are?
So I'm partly secure.
I think you are, actually. I think you're secure.
Yeah, but I have some avoidances in some areas.
Okay. I think you're secure because like you're married, right? And you're in this kind of stable relationship. I remember that from when we were talking before. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a certain vibe. Once you start to see it, you're like, oh, secure people have a certain just, you know? And we can lean a certain way too. It's like you can be there all but the most stressful times, you know? I am doing so great in this area.
I'm so proud of you.
Oh my God. The work that I have done to be in the relationship that I'm in. I've been in it for 6 months and it has been like massive amounts of plank, but I've really risen to the challenge and I'm doing great. And whether or not, whatever happens here, these are my skills now.
Yes.
That is so great that you say that, because I think, and maybe I have this too, because this is what I tell Kristen, so I need to stop telling her that once you find the person you're supposed to be with, like everything is easy after that.
But really? Do you think that's true?
No, probably not.
I'm going to plug in my phone.
Here's the thing.
I will say this. So I was in a relationship for almost 6 years and it was not easy, but we did a lot of work. And I'm going to say there's this other thing. So I think there's two pieces. There's willingness and there's capacity. People can have willingness, but no capacity. They can have capacity, but not willingness. You need to be with somebody who has both. I was in a relationship with someone who had willingness. We went to so much couples therapy. It just didn't move the needle because the capacity wasn't there. And our particular dynamic, like the therapist would say this, they would be like, oof, oof. You guys have it hard. And some combinations of people have it really hard. Now I'm in a relationship where it's like a miracle. Like somehow we just don't run into each other. And I think when you say it's easy, that's what you mean. It's like, yeah, we're just not crashing into each other at every minute. Things he does it just doesn't really bug me. I'm like, it's fine. You can be like that. It's fine. It just sincerely does not bother me, you know? So those are the graces that are just belong to any given couple. And I also think that there's a DNA of every relationship, and that's what that relationship is. It's like a baby or anything. It's like it does not really change in temperament. You know, human beings have 9 things of temperament and they don't change across your life, you know. And I feel like relationships are kind of like that too. They are what they are. So it's like if you're trying to change something fundamental, that it won't work. If you're trying to get skilled, that can work. You know, so we're all deep in this shit, you guys. What the heck?
Okay. That guy I went on 5 dates with. I want to know her advice about that.
Yeah, to ask me. Let's talk about him.
So I've been on 5 dates with this guy. He's very successful. He's a great guy. And we get along great, but we have not been intimate yet together.
Okay. What's his feeling? 5 dates is a lot of dates to be on this still.
The last time we talked about it, he said he was intimidated. And that's why he hasn't gone
for it. Okay, I'm going to say something. So there's this idea of not wanting to want. Okay. So sometimes when people are trying to protect themselves, they don't want to want. And sometimes a low level of desire comes from not wanting. I don't want to want you. It's going to be too vulnerable. I'm going to feel out on a limb. I don't want to feel that. Or I only am willing to feel that with somebody that I know I'm going to discard. I'll feel that with somebody I just met, but I won't feel it. That's why sometimes you'll find that an avoidant in particular, they love brand new dating, right? They love dates 3 through 6. And then they're trying to figure out how to get out of it. Because once you start to want something from them, they shut down. They're like, okay, this is too much. I'm going to go to the next person that wants nothing from me and I don't want anything from them and they cannot hurt me because I don't give a fuck, you know? Is that okay if I'm swearing? So
I love it.
All day, yes.
So, it sounds more like he's in that spot, right? I think what I would do if I were you, because I get real creative with my sexuality. I think sexuality is a real place of creativity. And that if I'm you, I'm just going to want to get in there and just see who I am with this person and how I can connect, basically, I mean, to put a fine point on it, to my pussy in this person's presence.
Yo, I love you so much because literally the fifth date, he came to my apartment and I texted Noni and I was like, I bought some sexy lingerie. Oh, like, I'm going to try to seduce him. But it didn't happen.
I don't want you to seduce
him. It still didn't happen.
Hold on. I want you to connect to your pussy. It's different. It's not for him. It's not, he's not an object. In the seduction story, he's an object that you're going to perform on. I'm really not into that. I don't, gosh, you guys are making
you
me
have
say
to
so
break
much
down.
Stuff.
Wait, break down what that
I know. Let me break that down. So, when please. I first got involved in the, this is what happens for me when I'm in a new relationship, brand new. Like, I don't, first of all, I'm very clear. I'm not having sex with you unless we're going to be in a relationship or unless you, this is a bridge to somewhere, not a bridge to nowhere. And most men, if you say, look, I want to have a relationship, I'm really not here to be friends with benefits or just check it out or just whatever, they'll be like, okay, never mind, if they don't see that there's a possibility. Because no, they just won't do it. They'll do don't ask, don't tell, right? Most men will do don't ask, don't tell. So if you ask and you tell, they'll be like, okay, thanks. Thanks for that info. I don't want to hurt anybody. So, but what I remember in the early stages of really the last probably two or three relationships I've had, and that's going back like 10 years now, in the beginning, I'm not trying to like have sex with a guy. I'm trying to see what it's like to be me in their presence. And a lot of times they'll be confused by this. They'll be like, I don't know what to do, you know, because they're used to where everybody puts their helmets on and now we're going to do sex. And then it's like, everybody's going to perform, you know what I mean? And I'm like, no, I don't want that. Here's what I want. I want to find one spot that we are connecting, just one spot in the scheme of an erotic map. I want to go to that spot. I want to meet you there and I want to see what happens. And just breathe into that spot. And something happens, but it's a connection and it's real. And then you never run out in this way. And then the next time when you, so you sort of go down that road and either you sort of create it together. It's way more intentional. In fact, I had this guy say to me, wow, I'm not used to being this intentional.
Oh my God.
And it's well, like, yeah.
I love that. And I just want to pinpoint the thing you said about the pussy thing. It's so funny you said that because I take S Factor. I don't know if you've heard of it.
Yeah.
But actually Mama Gina is in my class. And I'm sure you know who that is. And she wrote this book about exactly what you're saying about connecting to your pussy and like, what does your pussy want? And like, who does your pussy want?
Or activate it with different people. Because honestly, my pussy could probably get activated with just like a lot of people because it's mine. So it's like, where am I deciding to activate myself? And what is the tone of each of these activations? They're all good, honestly. They're all interesting. And I also think like we have all these ideas about what it's supposed to look like when we just get to name our own thing that feels good. You know, I just sort of am like way less interested in like performances and orgasmic like journeys toward orgasm. I'm more interested in like knowing you, play, exploration, just like relating. It's way harder though, way harder. And not that many people necessarily are into it. But if you find somebody who is into it or somebody is like senses in their heart that this is what they need in their life and the way that they're supposed to grow, now you're in a relationship on a whole other basis than whatever role playing, because role playing is so pernicious. Like it's just a dead end, you know?
Yeah. And I just want to say one last thing, because it kind of goes back to your book, right? Where it's like, you're more of like giving the love and being the love and attracting that instead of trying to get something from someone all the time.
Yeah.
So that's really great.
I'm just here to, I've got this thing and I'm here to share it and like we can explore it. See what we have together. You bring yours, I'll bring mine. I mean, it's not for everybody, but when you move into this space, it, first of all, it takes you out of so much, like, do they like me? You know what I'm saying? Because you're either connected or you're not. You're creating something in this paradigm as opposed to getting something.
Yes.
No.
Oh, I could stay in this space forever.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's just, it's so fascinating. And I just, I would love to, if you could just describe what that looks like. I'm just still trying to wrap my brain.
What looks like?
Like what, when you said, just finding a point where we can both connect and take a moment. Like, okay. What is that?
So it was like, so break I'll it say, down. Well,
you don't have to get too much.
No. I just want to be discreet and I want to have boundaries. So I was like, well, here's what I would do. I'll pitch it. I'm really into consent. I'm into consent about everything. I'm into consent basically about a first kiss. I'm like, oh, we're going to kiss. That's what I usually say. Oh. And then I'll be like, okay. I like that. Let's do it again. And then if I'm like, oh, it looks like we're getting sexual now, you know, I'll name it. I'm probably people who want to go to sleep, you know, they're not interested in having sex with me. But anyway, so it'll be like, well, here's what I have in mind. What if we find a spot and we see what happens and we take it from there? And then the other person goes, okay. So then you, okay, well, let's move to this other spot where we can really relax and start to see what happens. And then something starts to happen. And then you have to watch that part of you that wants to come in and start performing, for lack of a better word, and doing something you saw in a movie or acting sexy or doing whatever. And then sometimes I'll just say like, oh, wow, whew, this is going really fast. Whoa, I just need to take a breath. Like it's really vulnerable, really moment to moment. It's almost like a meditation. And I'll even say that, like, this is like a meditation. Let's just breathe together for a minute or let like whatever.
That's hot.
Right. I'm just like, yes.
And honestly, I never stopped doing this. It's not like I'm done doing this. I'm in a relationship 6 months. I'm done. Now I'm even more like my latest pitch is, I think we should do a session that's just exploration. There's no end. There's no beginning. We're just going to explore and just try different things. And it can't be a time when you like need something or you know what I mean? It can't be like, you know, like a person needs to have a certain kind of, you know, you want to have your sex in a week, right? But then you want to add in one time where there's no goals, no nothing. And then I'm with somebody pretty great. He goes, oh yeah, and schedule it. I'm like, yes, schedule it. Because now no one's taking a risk to ask. No one's going to get turned down. You know when it's going to happen. You can kind of get some ideas for it. You're taking out all the things that cause the anxieties to come in. And then I was like, okay, so you tell me when do you think would be good? And I didn't even know if he'd have an answer. And he's like, the weekend. I'm like, oh, yes, I get that. Okay. And then for me, it would be afternoon or later, you know? So now we're both really excited about this thing. And then I can try out things that I wouldn't be able to try out necessarily if you're in one of those experiences where you're like, okay, you know, you're like, you want to get off or whatever. And like, this is something else. This is like doing scribbling. Except sexually. You know what I'm saying? So it's so like great. You just want to like see what happens and try some new stuff so that you stay in the area of like exploration and learning this person. And I don't think you're ever going to run out of interesting things because it's conversation. It's just with bodies. I mean, we're talking a lot about sex. Here's my other main thing about sex, guys. Because I don't talk about sex on my Instagram, but it's a big topic for me. I also think that sex is the area where you take a lot of the tensions, a lot of the unsolvable problems, a lot of the things in your relationship, and you metabolize them through your sexual relationship. And it's like you have your sexual relationship is sort of a Rorschach for the whole relationship and all the energies as a whole. So like exploring your power dynamic, exploring what kind of energies you guys get into, that to me is a huge part of the purpose of a sexual relationship, not just whatever, do orgasm, you know?
You do, This is so great and amazing. And
we could do this forever. Look, if we've
already could do this all night. Like, listen,
100% forever.
I could do this all night. This is how I became a relationship expert. It's like, this is my favorite shit to talk about, basically.
This is the best. I'm so glad we went down that road, actually.
Yeah, I think that what we wanted this podcast to be, this is exactly what it is. It's like, it sounds like grown women-ish. And us being both in our 40s and like doing this podcast and sharing our life experiences.
Yeah.
Like, you just blew our mind. Like, we're taking notes over here.
I'm going to go make a sex appointment today.
Well, honestly, I feel like 30s, you start to figure it out. 40s, you're really in it. Now I'm in my 50s and you're like, oh, wait, 50s. I mean, it's the best. I don't think it's going to get worse. That's the thing. I don't, especially not the sex part. Wow. Because sex is about meaning. And it's like, meaning is something that you need to be grown, as you say, to bring to something and to allow those meanings to be there. It's, you know, and then not every partner is equally able to do it, but you just need to be really lovingly sort of in a spirit of play. And I think you can do amazing things, you know, and keep something really interesting and alive. So
gorgeous. So amazing.
That's what I'm doing.
That's what you're
doing. Yay! You're amazing. You're my inspiration.
Well, we're all in it. You know what I mean? If you see it, you are it. You know what I'm saying?
I do love what you said at the beginning about just how you became a relationship expert and the whole trial and error. And I feel like you probably have people's ear more than anyone else because you're so candid about your own experiences. So we know that Valentine's Day is coming up.
Right.
And we have a lot of people, you know, it's also on top of it, a pandemic.
Right.
People are alone and they're feeling a little, you know, down about it. What would you say to anybody that's single during this time?
I mean, it is a hard time. I always say it's like in the fortune cookie, you know, you read it and then at the end you put on in bed. It's like, that's how this is. It's like whatever's going in your life in a pandemic, you know what I'm saying? It's like, it just doubles down on whatever it is. But I think the best thing about the pandemic is that it reveals stuff. It revealed to me certain things that I was not able to see because I was so busy running around, being all busy in my life. And I started to take immediate action in the areas that I needed to take action. So if you're seeing something in your singlehood, I would be looking for what is being revealed to me that I need to address at a really deep level. And what risks am I willing to take to start to address those things in a new way? What new actions am I willing to take? That to me, it's less about going out and dating. I mean, yes, date for sure. But it's more about shifting things, places where I'm in limited belief, places where I'm in limited capacity, or places that I'm in limited willingness. And so as I move those things and go to those places and take those risks and confront myself, shifts occur. And as shifts occur on the inner level, shifts occur in the world, because it all starts, things move from the inner world to the outer world. And so it's always going to start in here. So yes, you want to continue to date. I would just put down all judgment, everything you think you know, set it aside, just start exploring things. And every single thing that's in your life is there for you. It's like, it's all useful. You know?
Yes. You said something in one of your Instagram videos. You said, things are not happening to me. They're happening for me.
Exactly.
And I took that, I made it a quote on my story. I tagged you and I got so many comments on it because it's such an empowering context to move from.
Just imagine that everything happening in your life right now is what you prayed for and what you chose. And then try to figure out how this is going to help you come to some new understanding about what's happening in your life. It's like, we're not victims. Even when somebody's victimizing me, I'm not actually a victim. I have a video that I just did the other day about this. It's like, you just have to do whatever little bit you can do. And then that gives way to the next little bit. And then that gives way to the next little bit. And then pretty soon you're free in that little area. And then you move to the next thing or whatever. I mean, you guys, we could talk forever. I also want to say, guess what? This shit is, your shit is going to be your shit for life. You know what I mean? I'm 56. I'm getting it. Oh, it's not going to go away. But you know what changed? I don't act out anymore. That's the difference. I don't bring that stuff and act it out in my relationships, in my life, the way I used to. I still feel the same because I have those experiences. My traumas are my traumas. Maybe they'll go away, but I'm not even waiting for that to happen. I'm just glad that I no longer have to reenact it over and over in my relationships. So lots to deal with. Yeah.
Oh, well, we had a couple of fan questions. So Noni, we want to do that now? And then
let's do the fan question. Okay. My partner is a homebody and I'm a free spirit and love to go out. Mm-hmm. How do I live my spontaneous lifestyle without upsetting my partner?
Oh, he gets upset when you do your thing. I would be like, do you get upset when he does his thing? Here's what you guys got to do. You got to negotiate. I would start by going, let's make a deal that we're not going to get upset about the way we are. You're this, I'm this. Let's just accept that. Nothing wrong with you. Nothing wrong with me. Now, where is your issue? So if his issue is being alone on Saturday afternoon or whatever, well, we can negotiate around that. Is his issue that she's a certain way? Well, we got to get over that because people are who they are. And our job is to be in loving acceptance of the other person, not wish they were another way. That is not good for anybody. So they can negotiate each individual time. If he doesn't want her to go out, you know, they can, like I said, they can make deals. Like, it's really about like, what do you really need? What does he really need? He must really need one or two things. He's not going to have it all because whatever, we're not children. We're grownups. We understand we're not going to get it all, but what do I really need? And then they can go from there and she can say the same thing. They'll figure it out.
I love that. Everything is negotiation.
Yeah, they'll figure it out. It is. It's about negotiating. Yeah.
Here's Nausicaa's question, which is very similar to the other one. Yeah. How can you make the other person not annoy you and just accept you aren't the same in how you go about your day?
Well, you can't make the other person not annoy you. You have to decide not to be annoyed. So you have to look underneath annoyed. What is annoyed? Okay, first of all, annoyed at baseline is I shouldn't feel something. Whatever they're doing is making me feel something. And it's I shouldn't feel it. I shouldn't have to feel it. And I'm like, really? Because that's not the life. That's not life. Life is sometimes you feel shit you don't want to feel. People do things you don't want them to do. You need to emotionally mature out of a worldview that is very self-centered, where the self is like, well, my self doesn't like that. You know, it's like thumbs up, thumbs down, thumbs up, thumbs down. You got to get a grip on that. Cool down your brain. Have your brain be in neutral. Yep. Neutral is where, okay, whatever, right? Not in a dismissive way, in a, oh, there's a cloud moving across the sky. Like just neutralize so much of your thinking about what this other person is doing.
Yeah.
Pay a lot less attention to them.
Mm.
Just take your eyes off that person. They're just over there living. They're trying to live like Kim Kardashian.
It's so powerful. It really is so powerful, Tracy. It's just like, don't make anything wrong. Just like choose to
That's a
accept
habit.
It.
Exactly. That's a habit of mind making things wrong. Or like, I don't like it. I'm like, have a seat. That part of myself, I'm like, it's okay. You can ride, but you're going to have to be in your car seat. This is like when I had a little kid, when I had a toddler. You're going to have to stay in your car seat, okay? And I'll give you some snacks. But you're gonna have to chill back there.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, this was so amazing. Thank you so much.
What's next for having you? You guys, this was fun.
This was really fun. So what's next for you?
Oh, what's next? Well, I'm going back to LA probably next week. I'm going to start shooting 20 episodes of Family or Fiance. I've got my scripted projects that I'm working on, and you know, and then who knows? I mean, I feel like the pandemic has opened up life, and I'm not sure what happens after that, but I'm excited to see what happens after that. And I'm just willing to embrace even more good things. So,
well, we love you so
love
much.
You guys. This was
you're amazing. Thank us. You so much.
Anytime.
For everything.
Anytime. Thank you. Have a great night.
Absolutely. Good luck with your boo. Oh.
All right. Talk soon.
Bye, JC. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for listening or watching today's podcast. I hope you guys got some amazing things that you can take with you. I know I did.
Yes, and my dreams were fulfilled. And honestly, I really want to say that anything's possible, because this was like a dream of mine to have her on the show, and it happened. So thanks for watching and listening, and we'll catch you on the next one.